Now let's tackle a couple of big issues in one bite: Middle East peace and the US presidential election campaign. Foreign policy is one of the areas where Donald Trump has upset the apple cart most dramatically. And what he's done has been stridently and universally condemned by the political establishment and the commentariat. But they, of course, once again, have been wrong. Trump has been successful in global affairs. He's stood up to China and forced trade concessions. He's defused the North Korean situation. He's pushed European allies to contribute more in NATO arrangements. And he's called time on the costly Paris Climate Agreement. And importantly, he's tried a different, less interventionist approach in the Middle East. Remember almost 3 years ago when he decided to recognise Jerusalem as the capital of Israel?
Today, I am delivering. I've judged this course of action to be in the best interests of the United States of America and the pursuit of peace between Israel and the Palestinians. This is a long overdue step to advance the peace process and to work towards a lasting agreement.
At the time, of course, the critics lined up immediately to predict Trump's bold announcement would create more conflict in the Middle East.
The national security experts around the president cautioned him strongly not to do this. Vice President Pence supported him. UN Ambassador Nikki Haley said go ahead. But when it came to the defense secretary and the secretary of state, they were first and foremost worried about the ramifications for those key Muslim allies who are going to be alienated by this decision. And we need in that war against terrorism, as the president would say. It will also have huge ramifications for any kind of immediate peace process and the security of U.S. personnel. You're already seeing alerts go out to diplomatic posts, and I am told that that threat level will be raised later today because this is so incendiary. There is concern there could be immediate blowback and immediate security risks.
And, of course, it wasn't just the media. It was politicians, diplomats, the UN and other world leaders, including the Pope.
Rivolgere un accorato appello affinché sia impegno di tutti a rispettare lo status quo della città in conformità con le pertinenti risoluzioni delle Nazioni Unite.
And we've always regarded Jerusalem as a final status issue that must be resolved through direct negotiations between the two parties based on relevant Security Council resolution.
من تداعيات هذا القرار على استقرار المنطقة والعالم وما يمثله هذا من إجحاف بحقوق الفلسطينيين والعالم العربي والإسلامي.
Öyle veya böyle bu iki durumda açıkçası hukuk dışı bir karar olacaktır.
Perhaps the Pope is not infallible after all. And what about Joe Biden, the man who could be president in 2 months' time? Well, despite saying for years that Jerusalem should be recognised, he said last year that it was the wrong thing to do by Donald Trump, but he wouldn't undo it.
If you are elected president, would you reverse that?
Not now, I wouldn't reverse it. I wouldn't have done it in the first place.
This tells you so much about a career politician, doesn't it? He was happy to say for years that it was the right thing to do to recognise Jerusalem, but we know he wouldn't have had the spine to do it now. And now he says it was wrong for Trump to actually follow through and do it, but he wouldn't and won't undo it. All talk, all show. He ought to grab a Bible and read about the Pharisees. Biden's position is unclear. It is weakness personified. And if we fast forward to today, we can see how the predictions of the spineless naysayers turned out. Under Trump, and with a ceremony at the White House, Israel has now established diplomatic relations with the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain. These are the only Arab peace deals delivered for decades since relations were established with Jordan and Egypt. So Trump's diplomacy in the Middle East has not been incendiary at all. It's been quite the opposite.
In Israel's entire history, there have previously been only two such agreements. Now we have achieved two in a single month. And there are more to follow.
And you have heard from the president that he is already lining up more and more countries. This is unimaginable a few years ago.
Now, as with any aspect of Middle East diplomacy, there's more at play here than just the US president's deal-making. He's capitalised on shared interest. In this case, it's driven primarily by how the US, Israel and the Sunni Arab world are worried about Iran's ambitions and the role of its Shia client groups in Syria and Iraq. But Trump is the one who's seized on these shared interests. And if there's more to come, especially if he could crack the golden egg of Saudi Arabia, then the pressure and momentum for some kind of settlement between the Palestinians and Israel might become irresistible. Now, let's be realistic. This is the Middle East, where there are many false dawns, broken dreams and dashed hopes. But the latest developments are the most positive we've seen for decades. This deal won't directly turn into votes for Donald Trump, but it does sharpen the contrast between his strength and a weak Joe Biden. It does show that while the president talks up his game way too much, he does get things done, while Biden talks and talks and talks and says little of consequence. Watch this space.